Good morning, everyone. I'm John Arola. This is the Damage Report, and that over there is Anna Kasparian. No big deal. Anna's here. How's it go? That's her right over
that over
here.
There.
You'll see Anna Kasparian. How exciting! Always great to have you on, Anna. How you doing?
Really good to be here. Excited about the show. I will say, excellent story selection. I'm a little jealous. I think you're giving the main show a run for its money.
Thank you. I appreciate it. There's a couple of stories that I really wanted to get to that literally no one other than me would care about, so we didn't put it on, but I am depressed about that. Someday I'm going to host my own show that no one, literally I will be the only person that watches, and we will talk about lead and the Amazon and all that all day long. Anyway, this is going to seem really weird, and if you're on the podcast, apologies for this. Do I not look kind of a weird? Is there something going on with my skin tone right now? Do I not look
weird? No. Let me just say,
I feel weird.
No, you look great. You look like you've gotten some sun, whereas I look like I could use some sun, to be honest.
It's all lighting. I don't go outside. There are animals, including humans out there. Anyway, thank you everybody for being here. Anna and I are going to break down so much awesome news, including we're going to prepare yourself for the thing that is going to dominate maybe weeks of discourse around Ukraine and Russia. We're going to be breaking that down in just a little bit. Responding to Ben Shapiro using income inequality as a shield against concerns over the environment. We've got fake right-wing populism. We have the right encouraging violence against those who want young LGBTQ individuals to feel accepted. Isn't that fun? And Trump desperately needs a new plane. So there's a lot to talk about. Thank you for being here. If you wouldn't mind hitting the like button and sharing the stream, that would be great, because the algorithm basically doesn't acknowledge us, doesn't care about us, but perhaps you do. And if you want to send us comments, sweet super chats, all that, we'll respond as we go. With all that said, Anna Kasparian, are you ready to discuss the news?
I've never been more ready in my life. Let's do it, John.
I like it. Let's do it. Okay. The war on Ukraine continues. Hospitals being bombed. The situation is getting more dire. But I need you to prepare yourself for what is going to dominate the narrative going forward. It already has in the right wing. And I expect that to spread. And that is all about biolabs, biological research laboratories. And so how did this become such a big topic of conversation? Well, it started in a couple different places. One area though was back about 1 week ago. The Twitter user War Clandestine posted about, quote, "It certainly appears Putin is targeting the cities and locations with hashtag US biolabs present. He is 100% going after the alleged bioweapons." Okay, so you have a couple of randos on Twitter who tweet about this, and then it takes 5 seconds before it gets on InfoWars, which it did. InfoWars published an article titled, quote, "Russian strikes targeting US run biolabs in Ukraine," citing different Twitter posts saying that our biological weapons laboratories are believed to operate in many cities that were recently attacked by Russia. Okay, 8 minutes later, basically, state media accounts for both China and Russia are spreading them. Two Insider, by the way, has a great rundown of that. If you'd like to see some of how they have run with this particular narrative, you can see in this screenshot right here. And maybe that would have been it for a little bit. But Marco Rubio, just 2 days ago, spoke with the Undersecretary of State for Political Affairs, Victoria Nuland. And he asked if Ukraine has chemical or biological weapons. She responded that Ukraine has, quote, "biological research facilities," adding that the US government was quite concerned about the facilities falling into Russian hands. So she then went on to say that it's a classic Russian technique to blame the other guy for what they're planning to do themselves, implying that if there are biological weapons or chemical weapons that are used, well, that's not on them, that's those damn US bio labs out there. And so then that puts us to where we're at as of the last day. That little conversation between Rubio and the undersecretary, and immediately Fox was off. And we'll talk about this, and more importantly, why I think this matters. Not necessarily what the conversation is focusing on today, but where it is likely to go. I'm curious though, for you, Anna, in your daily digesting of the news, what have you been coming across? What do you make of all this?
The disinformation, especially in regard to bioweapons, it's uncanny to what we experienced in Syria. The only difference is the world's paying much closer attention to the actions of Russia in Ukraine because it was such a brazen, illegal invasion of a sovereign country. But the narratives coming from Russian propaganda are very similar, strikingly similar to what we saw in Syria after Assad, with the help of the Russians, would carry out chemical weapons attacks. They would come out and say, you know, the United States is about to wrongfully make an unfounded claim of us doing a chemical weapons attack in Syria. And then they would do a chemical weapons attack in Syria. And I do think it's really important to emphasize wording here, because the video featuring Marco Rubio that the right wing and all of these conspiracy theorists love to point to features the statement that there are there are biological research facilities. Like, literally every country has that. She did not say that they're developing biological weapons. There's absolutely no evidence that Ukraine was developing biological weapons to use against Russia. It's important to pay very close attention to wording. And more importantly, for the conspiracy theorists, anytime they cite something, make sure you actually read what they're citing, because oftentimes they misconstrue various reports or various pieces of evidence that they cite.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, or go beyond just misconstruing. A misconstrual can be honest. They are not always. Let me be clear though, before we catch up a little bit more on this, where I stand. I have no idea whether Ukraine has or is developing biological or chemical weapons. They're a power with a military. I wouldn't be shocked if they were. My point is not anything about that. My point is it takes maybe 3 days of some narrative about US biolabs. Maybe there's a connection to the US, which there is in truth, and we're gonna get to it. That disseminates 1 day, 2 day, 3 days. And then that now can be referred to justify anything that dishonest actors wanna justify. Maybe that's why Biden was doing whatever it was that he was doing, because of the secret labs. If there's something bad that happens, well, we don't have to take seriously the possibility that Russia is dropping 1,000-pound bombs. Maybe it was to cover up the bio labs. Maybe Russia was right to invade because of the bio labs. That's really the thing for me that worries me going forward. It's not that I don't believe that the US could be involved in whatever. I don't put anything past the US government. I'm very worried about the weaponization, not just of chemical weapons, but of this narrative to then take over and allow for anything else that predominantly the right, although it's not just gonna be the explicitly right that's running with this thing, wants to say.
Right. I think that it's very healthy to have that level of skepticism. And also the fear that you have is a legitimate one, because I have no doubt that you're right. This will be repeated over and over again by either useful idiots or bad faith actors. But I wanna also just bring one other piece of information to the audience, because the US State Department, I'm sorry, the Department of Defense has not denied that there are biological research facilities in Ukraine. In fact, if you go to the US Embassy in Ukraine website, you will get specific details about what they're doing. It says the US Department of Defense's Biological Threat Reduction Program collaborates with partner countries to counter the threat of outbreaks, deliberate, accidental, or natural, of the world's most dangerous infectious diseases. The program accomplishes its bio threat reduction mission through development of a biosecurity, biosafety, and biosurveillance measure. So they detail this online, like you can read the details of it.
It's not secret.
It's not secret. And more importantly, it's again, watch out for conflating biological research facility with developing biological weapons. Again, there is no evidence that they're developing biological weapons. That's what I'm trying to say here.
Yeah, and for the people who will take whatever evidence they want to pretend is there, or even if evidence develops that Ukraine is, you know who has developed these things? The US and Russia. Like, they're honestly saying that, like, well, some are just expressing fear. Putin will get access to these labs. He doesn't need access to these labs. He has weapons. He has thousands of nukes. It's such a fake concern. They have them. We have them. We don't need to set up secret labs in Ukraine. The US has tons of different weapons of mass destruction. So it's like this feigned concern, again, to breed an environment of we can no longer trust anything that's going on. And that is the battlefield that bad faith actors like to operate on. It's not that they will, that they're ever 100% wrong. They'll sometimes tie what they say to actual facts, like there are biological research facilities. It's that they want to create an atmosphere where anything goes. Any claim can be made because, I mean, honestly, who knows what to trust at this point?
Exactly. Yep.
And you know, very briefly, Jennifer Griffin's on Fox was on with Sean Hannity last night. And she, look, to the extent that you trust the US narrative about the relationship with these labs, why we've had this partnership for some time, she laid all of that out. She was very clear about it. That is not, and in fact, did not stop Fox News from just saying, oh, thank you, Jennifer Griffins, for acknowledging what is actually going on. Nope, we're going back to crazy town, because immediately Tucker Carlson was talking about them, showing the Nuland testimony and talking about. So when she says that Russia could potentially use this for disinformation, he now is going to preemptively defend Russia by saying, oh, you think they're running a disinformation thing? No, it's us, in fact. When it was Rubio that brought this up in the first place, it's already gone to QAnon conspiracy forums. They're all over this thing. You can see Media Matters has done a summing up of how this is spreading QAnon, which no longer has any connection to actual Q. It's just a catch-all for all sorts of conspiracy theories. They're all over this. Ian Miles Chong, who opines on everything going on and has a right-wing following, says she confirmed every conspiracy theory, talking about Victoria Nuland. Notably, she did not. But they're fine with it, and people are already making money. Media Matters is a great breakdown. There are tons of conspiracy theories being spread about this, way in advance of any actual evidence that it has ads on it, that is making money on it. And just wait. Now they're gonna be going mad with this thing over the next few days. And so my concern is there have been aspects of the conversation around Ukraine that I have not liked. The demonization of random Russians, the completely lacking in critical, you know, critical thinking, jingoism and all that. These are things we should all be concerned about when we go to war. But largely we've agreed that the aggression is bad and that we should help people who are being targeted. There are a lot of people in media that are not happy with that being the discussion that's being had. That's not profitable for people with right-wing audiences. But this narrative, this just might be. Anna, what do you think?
Yeah, I think that you are right about that. And look, any information, any claim coming from either side should be taken with a grain of salt. And look, I completely agree with the analysis that this is an illegal invasion of Ukraine by Russia. Vladimir Putin is indiscriminately, you know, doing strikes on civilian territories, civilian areas. He claims that he's going to honor these safe corridors, which allow for the civilians to evacuate the country, but then he ends up targeting them. Like, these are facts. These are things and you can see evidence of that all over the place, including the war crime that was committed yesterday with the bombing of a children's hospital. I mean, it's just absolutely disgusting stuff. With that said, though, there's also propaganda coming from the Ukrainian side. And I just want people to look at all of that with a skeptical eye. Don't take what either side says at face value and question the claims that others make, right? Check the work, check the sources, check the research that they've done, and just be careful to not help amplify intentional disinformation or disinformation that's being spread by useful idiots. That's all I have to say about it.
That is super responsible. And I think our audience can vouch for the fact that we've been doing that. Obviously, I am not unbiased on this, the two sides of this war, but we do tell people you should not routinely trust any government, including governments that you feel sympathy for. I think that you're totally right there. Okay, with that said, we're gonna launch into our first break, answer some of your comments. When we come back, Ben Shapiro does not want anything done to protect the environment because that would cost his benefactors money. He has a shield now to ward off concerns over the environment. He's using the working class, and we'll break it down after this.
know there are people out there who have sort of been looking at this and they think maybe it's on purpose, right? Maybe it's conspiratorial. Maybe basically Joe Biden is deliberately driving up energy prices so as to get everybody to embrace the sort of Green New Deal idea. If so, he's a moron, because the fact is that when energy prices are high, people have far less tolerance for this sort of gambling around and pretending that green energy is going to be the solution. Environmentalism is the privilege of rich countries and rich people. People who are poor don't care about it.
Okay, Ben Shapiro, a guy whose entire career has been given to him by millionaires and billionaires, is here to tell you what poor Americans think about and what should be done to advance their interests. There is more to what he said, which is not just purposefully dishonest, but also just casually wrong in a lot of ways that we're going to break down. Here's a bit more of what he had to say.
People who are struggling to get by, they do not care about carbon emissions. They care about making sure they can get to work and get food on their family's table. That is what they care about. So if that's the plan, to purposefully drive up the price of energy in order to encourage people to go green, it is likely to backfire on the Democrats in pretty dramatic fashion. Instead, it seems more like to me, because Hanlon's razor I tend to attribute to stupidity rather than malice, although in this case it's stupidity combined with malice. When it comes to the Democratic Party, it seems much more like they are taking advantage of the price spike in order to push the Green New Deal kind of stuff, because their preferred solution is always the solution to any given problem. You saw this with Build Back Better, right? Inflation was happening, and so Joe Biden was like, Build Back What I'm gonna do is gonna solve inflation. You're like, wait, that, no, like clearly not.
Conservatives are getting better at humor, and it's scaring us libs. Anyway, it was a terrible impression. So there's a lot there that's wrong. Before we launch into fact checks, I do want to give you a little bit of context on what he is saying. It was summed up very well by Justin Barragona on Twitter. Back on March 3rd, Ben Shapiro called Joe Biden a coward for not sanctioning Russian oil. He's sanctioning other things. Why doesn't he sanction the oil? So they ban the import of Russian fossil fuels. He immediately turns around and says they're an excuse so he can then blame Putin and Russia for gas prices. Rarely do you get a damned if you do, damned if you don't demonstration in such immediate, clear terms. But anyway, Anna, the larger point he's making is that Biden, who in his telling loves the Green New Deal and wants to pass it, is using this. He's purposefully driving up gas prices, which are great for his presidency, clearly. And poor people don't care about this stuff, shouldn't care about this stuff. It has no effect on their lives. What do you think about these claims?
Well, I actually think that he's hitting on a vulnerability in terms of what the response has been in terms of climate change, which the left should be a little more aware of. And I'll get to that in a moment. But first, I want to just talk about the like orchestrated effort to make it appear as though this is some sort of conspiracy to get the Green New Deal passed. Listen, I have not heard a single Democrat in a position of power, certainly in the White House, who is advocating for green energy right now. Not a single example of it. Jen Psaki has been asked by Peter Ducey over and over again in press conference after press conference about the Keystone XL pipeline, about, oh, this is the result of focusing on renewable energy, you know. And he's been slapped down over and over again, not with Psaki saying that we need to focus on renewable energy, but with Psaki correctly pointing out that the United States is the top oil and natural gas producer in the world. We're number one. Now, it's effort to understand why gas prices are high. Now, of course, it has to do with the sanctions on an oil producing country like Russia. But how are oil prices established? Is it by the president of the United States unilaterally implementing prices that he likes? No, it doesn't work that way. The way it works is you have oil producing countries that are part of what's known as the OPEC cartel, and they oftentimes will withhold the production of energy with the very intention of artificially increasing energy prices so they can turn a profit. In the United States, even though we are the top oil producing country, the top natural gas producing country, these natural resources are not owned by us, the US taxpayers. It's not owned by the government. It is owned by private corporations who are seeking to maximize their profits. And so what we see in the United States is the export of these natural resources to other countries that have made deals with the private oil and gas industries within the United States, right?
Yeah.
So if Biden wanted to, he could unilaterally decide through an executive order to ban all exports. But I don't hear a single conservative talk show host or a single Republican lawmaker advocate for that, which I find curious. They don't ever mention it. The other thing that could be done on a state level is if there are certain gas taxes, they could be temporarily suspended, which I think it's fair to have a conversation about that as gas prices are like outrageous and it really is hurting the working class. So I'm open to that discussion. But overall, the only thing that Ben Shapiro said in that argument that we should be careful about is, you know, of course, climate change overwhelmingly, disproportionately impacts poor people, not just in this country, but around the world. And the response to the climate emergency so far has been about individuals, what individuals need to do to respond to the climate emergency. I think that strategy has been disastrous because it is true that the very people who are most impacted with climate change are also most impacted by individual efforts to combat it. And so this goes back to the point that we make over and over again. We need to focus on the actual polluters rather than putting the onus on individuals, including the working class.
Exactly. No, you're 100% right. And we oppose the idea of making it all about individuals. If people want to be a part of the solution, they can, but there's only so much individuals can do. It's a ruse. It's an evasion to get people to distract themselves with little things they can do to help out a little bit and protect the actual established economic interests from any threat to their dominant position, which is also, by the way, the mission statement of the Ben Shapiro show. He is pretending that he cares about poor people's, like the cost of gas. He has no interest in long-term structural changes that will take away the ability of these authoritarian leaders of oil producing countries to be able to not only do what's happening now, but to do it again in 2 years or in 5 years or in 10 years. He wants to keep the status quo, but he wants to spin his followers up until they're dizzy. And they don't know how to advocate for their actual interests, pretending to care about them. First of all, poor people do care about the environment. They do care about their ability to breathe clean air, drink clean water. They care about the future. If you take a look at polls of what countries think climate change is a serious threat, it is predominantly the poorest countries in the world that take it the most seriously. And in times like this, you can already see there's tons of articles about people becoming far more interested in things like electric vehicles because of the situation. They do not agree with the right wing that the solution is just to drill more oil. And it's good that they don't, because as Anna points out, the right wing in situations like this will always pretend. Like they give a wink and a nod to effectively resource socialism. We'll drill more and that'll help us. No, as Anna's pointing out, no, it will be sold on the international market. It will make pennies difference, if anything at all. It isn't being drilled so that we can then use it. They understand exactly what message they're sending and what will happen in reality. But as you've been seeing on screen, pollution related deaths happen almost entirely in low and middle income countries. And that same sort of situation can be found here in the US, where the poorest communities are the most affected. They do care about this. They are getting involved in environmental activism and centering concerns over the environment when choosing politicians. Ben's problem is that he doesn't want them to do that because he's there to protect corporations who would potentially be financially impacted by new regulations to lower carbon emissions. That is what this is about at the end of the day. He's using the poor, as the rich always do, to protect the rich, not the poor. Anyway, by the way, long term, really fast, by 2050, more than 570 coastal cities could be affected by sea level rise. As many as 1 billion people could be displaced by environmental hazards. Who's that gonna affect? The rich who can buy a second house and move? Or people who are gonna lose literally everything when their house goes underwater. Now, I understand he doesn't have the mental faculties to think about that, to respond to it. He said that when the sea level rises, people will just sell their house. To who? Nobody seems to understand. He certainly doesn't. And a ton of extra people, 100 million people are gonna be pushed into poverty just by climate change. over the next 8 years. That's the estimate. These are incredibly important issues, particularly for those at the on the lowest rungs of the economic ladder. He understands that. He just doesn't have their interests in mind.
The radical left, rich elites, woke corporations, academia, Hollywood, and the media, they're taking over America. That's your empire, right there, telling lie after lie, making excuses for chaos and violence, censoring truth that doesn't fit their agenda, amplifying anger and envy. They demand control, ruthlessly enforcing conformity, canceling any who stand in their way. But the truth is, we must stand in their way, because it's not just about us.
Okay, so that is an ad for Adam Laxalt, who is standing against the elites. He wants to get elected so he can fight against the elites. You see that in all of his public appearances. Campaign ads like what you saw right there. I'll give you a little bit of a recent interview. Take a look at this, what he chooses to focus on.
I think people are rising up and they're gonna send a big message to our elites, to Washington and to this administration.
All right, Adam Laxalt joining us live here, weighing in on that. This is how democracy works, elections, and they vote on the most important topics to them.
Great sign off by that Newsmax host. Anyway, so that's Adam Laxalt. He's a fighter for you against the elites. And I think he understands the elites and what will be needed to take them down, because he is 100% one of them. And this is going to serve as a reminder to you that the right wing understands that there is a lot of popular anger against those who have rigged the system against them. They're not interested in changing it, but they are interested in co-opting that anger, throwing around terms like the ruling class, as Tucker Carlson does, the elites, as Laxalt does. What you need to understand about him is his grandfather was governor of Nevada, was a US senator who started his own lobbying firm. His father was a late New Mexico Senator Pete Domenici. His mother was a US Senate staffer. He graduated from a posh prep school in Virginia, has 2 degrees from Georgetown. He co-chaired a presidential campaign. He's made millions of dollars at a law firm in Washington. But Anna, he's very worried about the elites who have been ruling over all of us and just get like making tons of money off of the power that they have accrued. And he's the guy to stop it. What do you think?
I think that for every politician, including this guy, you should not just listen to what they have to say on the campaign trail. In fact, you should just automatically assume that what they say on the campaign trail is a lie, and look to what they're actually proposing. So he is talking a big talk about, oh, the elites, and you know, we're gonna go after the elites. Sure, buddy. How exactly do you propose to do that? And I think that you learn a lot about where their heart really is. And look, it sucks that we're in a position where we even need to try to guess what's in the heart or mind of any given candidate or politician. If we had an organized effort to essentially bend politicians to our will, as this country did when it had a militant labor movement, you know, in the lead up to the New Deal, we would, you know, we just wouldn't have to worry about like speculating about what they actually genuinely mean. But you can do a little bit more of an investigation, not take what these people say at face value, and look at what their proposed solutions are. And I don't know, I would venture to say that it's very likely that a guy who has the kind of background that you just noted is not really interested in changing this country in a way that creates a better, less rigged economic system that actually looks out for workers as opposed to corporate interests. I don't know, I could be wrong, John. Let me know.
I think that it's probably a safe bet. And we bring up this individual to dunk on him because it's ridiculous and he's a complete phony, a complete sham. But maybe more importantly, this sort of tactic, pretending that you want to drain the swamp or fight the elites, it's underhanded, dishonest, and it results in right wingers voting for people who are directly opposed to their economic interests. That is long established. But it is, again, a demonstration that they get that people are angry. The anger is being funneled into all the wrong things, but it's out there. It is founded on truth, an understanding that things are bad, getting worse, and that almost no one in power cares at all about what happens to us. And so that being out there means that there's an opportunity for an actual strong populist. And by that, I mean an actual progressive, because right-wing populism is a massive scam. In practice is exactly the same as every Republican that has ever held office. It's xenophobia, anti-vax nonsense. They just occasionally use the term ruling class. That's all you get. And maybe that's an improvement. Maybe you like that. Fine, vote for it. Watch Tucker Carlson. But it isn't actually going to improve your lot in life. And so people like him will throw out these terms. Well, if we can advance to the last graphic, he's saying that he's endorsed by President Trump and Governor DeSantis. Well, okay, if you're against the elites, Trump was president for 4 years. DeSantis is governor right now. When is this supposed return to a magical past in America going to happen? Trump had 4 years. What did he do? Like, really, honestly, if you're conservative watching this, is this the movement that you were sold? Did he drain the swamp when he continually brought people into power that had served in previous Republican administrations and then ended up firing them, saying that they were terrible when he chose them and he knew their record? It is just such a sham, Anna. And it leaves me wondering, how do we get through to these people? How do we get them to understand that they vote for populism and what they get is homophobia, xenophobia, and that's pretty much it?
Well, I mean, ideally, what you would do is have an opposition party that genuinely offers real solutions to the frustrations that these people might have, right? And unfortunately, the mainstream Democratic Party doesn't do a good job of that. And, you know, I think that the Democratic Party puts itself at a huge disadvantage when they themselves campaign on progressive policies and then they don't carry it out. It honestly allows for the Republican voters who have already bought into the right-wing populism to dig their heels in even further. Because think about it, what does the Democratic Party really offer to counter Republicans and their faux populism? If it's not much, and if the Republicans aren't really offering much either, you got to keep in mind the one thing that they do give voters is a show. They give them the theater. They give them the manufactured culture wars. They give them enemies, exactly. They give them an opportunity to own the left, like that's, or own the libs, right? Like that has been honestly the most appealing thing among right-wing voters when it comes to people like Donald Trump. If you don't have something to offer people, it further emboldens these faux populists on the right. And it, you know, it helps to drive up support for them. And so I think the best response is to continue building a progressive coalition within Congress that can be a real answer, a real counterbalance to the faux right-wing populism that we see.
I like it. We're trying to. Important elections coming up this cycle. Everyone, don't check out. These are some important potential wins. Cisneros and of course Nina Turner and more. Okay, with that said, we're gonna take a short break. When we come back, the Don't Say Gay bill conversation has taken a couple of different incredibly dark turns. We'll describe those to you after this.
Everyone in the media is pushing the same narrative. The bill is homophobic. It has nothing to do with gays. You shouldn't be talking to kindergartners about gender identity, especially if you're not their parents. That's creepy. You should be arrested for that, in fact. You talk to a normal person's kids about sex in kindergarten, you get beaten up. You should be beaten up, please.
Okay, so that's Tucker Carlson talking about the reaction in terms of some in the media. Culturally, people are horrified by Florida's so-called Don't Say Gay bill that effectively tries to pretend, as so many GOP efforts do these days, that the community just does not exist, driving them into the shadows where the right would prefer them to be. So Tucker, in defense of bills like that, is trying to make any accepting, loving conversation about how there are different life experiences. Not everyone is exactly like Tucker Carlson. Those people are bad. Those people are coming for your kids. They get beat up. They should get beat up. He just stumbled into that. It was a complete accident that he implied that people who talk about gender, who provide an open, accepting environment for kids who are having a very difficult time, should be beaten up. This is a cable host with an audience in the millions advocating for violence against teachers. amidst, by the way, a multi-year campaign on the right to get the craziest people in the country to hound teachers over everything they say and do. Show up at the school board meetings, wait in parking lots outside. Now he's telling them, no, you should be beating up the parents if they do something that you don't like. Anna, what are your thoughts?
Well, I mean, this goes to show you how much the right wing has decided to dig its heels into creating or manufacturing non-issues, manufacturing culture wars, which then do have a negative impact on various disenfranchised groups. In this case, students who might identify as gay. But what this legislation really did is it otherized students. And so while it's true that in the end it got stripped down to something that only impacts students between kindergarten and third grade, what the whole debate has done is it has otherized students who are part of the LGBTQ community. That's the whole point. And so I have family members who are part of that community who have children. And their children are already getting bullied in school in Florida. And it's just incredibly depressing to see it. Because again, like let's just keep it real, everyone. The original bill was specifically focused on the LGBTQ community, okay? It had a provision in there that would allow for teachers and educators to out students to their parents before they were ready to come out. Yeah. That luckily got stripped out of the final bill because there was so much backlash. But let's ask ourselves this for a second. Were there really discussions about gay sex or homosexuality or any of that in kindergarten to third grade? That wasn't a thing, okay? They didn't start learning sex ed till like fifth grade at the very youngest. So like, again, they're creating this issue that doesn't even really exist. They're needlessly otherizing students who are already like, you know, dealing with questions and discomfort as a result of the climate that right wingers have already fostered. Like, they know what they're doing. And then what's even worse is how they're now twisting things to paint anyone who questions the consequences of this bill or consequences of this law as like somehow being supporters of pedophilia. It's really sick. It really is.
We're going to turn to that in one sec, because as we alluded to earlier in the show, there are multiple dark roads that this is going down. And again, in their effort to make sure that their voters pay attention to stuff like this, focus on stuff like this, center hatred in their political value system, and never take a look at the state of their life and wonder why Republican politicians don't deliver for them. That's what this is about. So Tucker will give you, oh, are you angry that they're talking to your kid? You should go beat up the teacher. And some maybe on the right wing might consider that to be extreme. Why would I beat these people up? Well, now here comes Laura Ingraham to provide a rationale. You should beat them up because they want to have sex with your kid. It all is going to come back to pedophilia. All right wing politics these days does because of QAnon. It hasn't gone anywhere. It's actually becoming more popular and they know exactly what they're doing. Here is Laura Ingraham making the case.
This has been my first year in preschool with a class of my own, teaching alongside another queer neurodivergent educator, and we have been rocking our two's class. We've been talking about gender and skin color and consent and empathy and our bodies and autonomy. It's been fabulous.
Oh my God, when did our public schools, any schools, become what are essentially grooming centers for gender identity radicals? As a mom, I think it's appalling, it's frightening, it's disgusting, it's despicable. Florida just passed a bill to keep this type of sexual brainwashing out of schools. Democrats, though, claim the bill is bigoted, branding it as the Don't Say Gay bill. Well, nice try. The real controversy, though, isn't this bill. It's that schools are peddling gender ideology when our international rankings in math, science, and reading are down across the board.
And I have to assume, I apologize, we cut off the video. I'm sure that she goes on to explain how if we make kids feel ashamed of themselves, they'll perform better in geometry. But anyway, she knows exactly what she's doing. In case you missed it, if you're focusing on the terrible things she was saying, here's the lower third that was playing on. Liberals are sexually grooming elementary students. So we have moved in maybe 3 days from the press secretary for Ron DeSantis, implying that anyone who has a problem with this bill is a pedophile, to just claiming they're all pedophiles. Fox News, again, audience in the millions, goes on to have this lower third, Dems happy to run on pro-grooming platforms. So if you're not tapped into right-wing insanity, what they're playing into there is a long-standing, intentionally inflammatory and dangerous stereotype of gay individuals as being predators and pedophiles. They are coming for your kids. So that teacher who she played, who seems like the most delightful person ever, who just wants kids to understand themselves and others, to feel a bit of compassion, Laura Ingraham would have you believe she wants to have sex with your kids. And any politicians who agree with her that kids should feel accepted, they too want to have sex with your kids. It's all QAnon. This is not some fringe. This isn't the fringe. This is the whole thing at this point, Anna.
Yeah, look, it does. None of this surprises me, right? If you don't allow the right wing to bully kids who identify as different from what they accept, well, then you're a pedophile. That's essentially what they're saying. If you don't allow us to bully these kids, if you don't allow us to make them increasingly uncomfortable about whatever lifestyle, whatever identity, whatever we don't like, well, then you're a pedophile. It's a way to intimidate people. It's a way to prevent them from feeling comfortable speaking out against what the real intentions of this type of legislation and this type of debate is really about. And I just want to note, the right wing not only does not care about human lives, children's lives, they also don't care about ensuring that your children get a quality education. Because if Laura Ingraham is genuinely concerned about reading and math and how our students are failing, maybe she would be concerned about the fact that the party that she supports so aggressively has advocated for and in some states really succeeded in defunding our public education system. How about have a discussion about that? But of course she's not. She's going to totally support the gutting of our public schools. And then when it's convenient for her and her political agenda or whatever talking point she has, she's going to point to the destruction that she took part in as proof for why we need to bully gay kids in schools. It's so stupid. Yeah. It really is.
Exactly. I don't understand how we as a society end up with, there are certain industries that they will pretend automatically to support. So they pretend that they like cops, even though they're okay with occasionally Trump supporters trying to beat them to death. They supposedly like coal miners, as long as the coal miners shut up and never advocate for their own interests. The second they do, forget the coal miners, we're not interested. They like truckers now, as long as the truckers are talking about vaccine mandates that don't exist. Again, the LA port right now has a trucker strike going on. They want more pay, so Fox News isn't sending any reporters there. Why not teachers? Why are teachers instantly suspect, instantly open to be disrespected, attacked, to have hatred and suspicion launched towards them? Is it because of their massive paychecks? Is it because every school teacher is so rich that they feel open to demonize them? I don't understand it, but this is ugly. This is dark. Give it to me.
Yeah. These are wealthy people who can afford to send their kids to private schools. They don't want to pay anything in the form of property taxes, for instance, to help fund public education. So when they make these anti-teacher, anti-public education arguments, it's really all about their greed and their desire to avoid having to contribute to a system that is meant to provide a basic education for everyone in this country, regardless of what their socioeconomic status is. They hate that. They hate the opportunity that it provides for people who don't happen to be their rich little children. That's what it's about.
By the way, we'll close on this. Belief in QAnon is up several points since Trump was voted out. By the way, since Trump is voted out, as far as I've seen, there has not been one single Q post. It doesn't exist as a thing, a movement that is based around this liar who's pretending to be in the US government. But it's out there and it's in fact bigger than it was a year and a half earlier. Isn't that amazing? Well, why not? They don't need to go to 4chan or 8kun or whatever it is to get the stuff that they like. They can watch Laura Ingraham, they can watch Tucker Carlson and get all of it right there. It's a great system they set up. Donald Trump had a bit of an emergency with his plane. Now, don't worry, he is all right. He was flying from New Orleans back to Palm Springs. He was forced to make an emergency landing. It was right before 11 p.m., taking him back from giving this speech to incredibly rich donors. So they landed, but he is not gonna allow, you know, a scary situation like that to pass without using it. He now wants money, and he is begging his supporters to help fund a whole new plane for him. So he sent out this email, and there's so many amazing things in this email. It says, "Do you remember Trump Force One? Before becoming the greatest president of all time, I traveled the country in my plane known as Trump Force One. I have a very important update on my plane, but I need to trust that you won't share it with anyone. My team is building a brand new Trump Force One." Now, I apologize in advance. By reading that, I shared it to people, and obviously they wanted to be private, which is why they sent it out to a mailing list of hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people. But anyway, don't share it. So we're gonna show you a picture. They're building a new plane. Would you like to see the new plane, by the way? The email beseeches his supporters. They show you this little photo. Do you wanna see it? It's pure white, by the way. That may seem random, but I feel like it's intentional. Anyway, do you know what happens if you click on that? Do you think that you see the plane? Cause that's what it says you'll see. Nope, you don't see the plane. Instead, you get an animated GIF of a plane taking off. And when you click on it, there's a thing that asks you to do donations, including monthly recurring donations of thousands of dollars each month. So he knows that people are thinking about this. If you're a Trump fan, you're legitimately probably worried about him, that they had engine trouble. So now you want him to have the best plane, and he is willing to take thousands of dollars from you. I will remind you, he supposedly is a billionaire who can buy with pocket change a new private jet. That's what he says anyway. He's acting as if he needs a little bit of help though, Anna. What do you think?
He's a scammer, of course. I mean, he's done this so many times. Why wouldn't he do it again? It's sad for the people who contribute to these campaigns, these Trump related campaigns. It sucks that they get scammed over and over again and they keep falling for it, especially the individuals who really can't afford it. You know, people are struggling, even members of the Republican electorate, and they just keep getting scammed by this guy. It's just, yeah. At what point do they wake up to it? I just don't get it. I really don't understand. It's the same people who fall for the televangelists and the prosperity preachers. It's like, guys, just, I feel for you. Just please stop. Like, just look into this a little more. Stop contributing money to these scammers.
And it's not just a similar scam as them. It's the exact scam. It's to get a private jet. That's what all of these televangelists wanted at the end of the day. It's the biggest symbol of luxury. By the way, can we go back? Just because the part about this is bothers me most is obviously the scamming, and in particular the scamming of older people. If we go back to the picture of the plane, the do you want to see the new plane? You'll see at the bottom of that, "I'll look for your response in 1 hour, friend." No, he won't. Like, if you are an older person who gets emails like this, I understand an email is, it reminds you of a letter that you might get. He's not looking for your response. When they send out their mass emails about like, "You better put your name on the Trump list, I'll be marching into his office with," no. There's no marching, there's no list. He's not looking at a list of names and like, "Where's Sally? She didn't sign this." That isn't actually happening. And they try to scam you in ways that can be more sophisticated than that. If we can jump ahead to the yellow graphics, we've talked about this multiple times, but when you see things like these boxes, please read them carefully. It isn't just Trump and just Republicans that do this, by the way. They will take thousands of dollars out of your bank account. You need to be very careful about what you sign on to. Gary Cooper in the YouTube chat said, "Pineapple shirt sighting reported." Yes, someone requested it earlier in the week. I don't remember exactly who it was, but I figured, you know what? It's been about a year since I tried to fit into that. Let's see if I can. And the verdict, kind of, not especially. Chase Essex sent in a super chat saying, "Are you ready, Dragon Squad? Who's wearing a pineapple button-up tee? John Iderola." It's not technically a tea, okay? This is me in fancy mode. I demand to be acknowledged.
Thanks for listening to the full episode of The Damage Report. Support our work, listen ad-free, access members-only bonus content, and more by subscribing to Apple Podcasts at apple.co/TYT. I'm your host, John Adirola. I'll see you soon.